HODL the Bitcoin.
Welcome back.
Live. Okay. Well, no. We'll do it live. Fuck it. Do it live. I'll write it and we'll do it live. And thing sucks.
Yeah. So if you were just watching, our connection just died. So we're back. We're here. We're bringing back in Julian and Brandon and Opti. We're good to go. We're back into it. Anyways, thank you guys for rejoining. We did it live and we failed, and so we're just doing it again. Yeah, I poured myself a drink because now I need one. but here we go. So we're back into why are we bullish? If you just clicked on this after the fact, this is why are we bullish. Very simple premise of the show. Each one of us here on the show has come with a reason for being bullish. It can be anything that floats our boat, whatever we're currently excited about in and around Bitcoin. The flow of the show is super simple. Number one, somebody drops their reason for being bullish, their chance to rant on it. Number two, altogether, we riff on the reason, comments, questions, rabbit holes. And number three, we rotate to the next person until we've all had a turn. And so we're just going to dive right into it. We were doing intros and everything down the line. Julian from formerly Kinetic Finance, now Get Based, one of the most awesome channels. I'm very excited about you, Adam and Isabella, absolutely killing it. Brandon from BTC Cards, which I'm proudly displaying my foil card here, and I've got a full collection, and Opti from a place that doesn't have as good of an affiliate link as me for Bitcoin Well, BitcoinWell.com.
This is fake news. BitcoinWell.com/SimplyBitcoin.
So we're going to dive right into it, gentlemen. I'm going to start with my reason for being bullish, and we'll just get going here. So my reason for being bullish this week is in and around a project that I've been kind of working on. We'll say semi in the background. I've started talking about it a little bit more publicly now. Basically I've been teaching people how to use Bitcoin for 8 years now, using the channel and doing one-on-ones and all this different stuff. And it's kind of the point where I can't really do it. All the one-on-ones myself. I'm a little too inundated with stuff. I still do them, but there's a lot of demand. People are very curious and want to know how to use Bitcoin. And so I have a partner here now in my hometown of Calgary, and we are putting together or have put together a company called Bitcoin Mentor. And the whole idea is I've spent a long time teaching people, and I want to level up more teachers to kind of, I guess I want people to be leveled up so that they can most effectively teach people how to use, secure, and do everything Bitcoin. And so Bitcoin Mentor is the website that we've set up. And we basically did a call for people to apply to be a mentor, somebody that's going to teach others. And the amount of interest that we got was staggering. So we got 350 applicants to be part of Bitcoin Mentor as basically as contractors that will come in and that will be trained by myself and then take on clients and teach them how to use Bitcoin. And we're in the process of narrowing that down and kind of picking the cream of the crop and then further training them to be on their A game. And so the reason I'm super bullish on this is because, again, the amount of interest, the amount of people that are so passionate about Bitcoin that they want to go forth and teach others about it, but also how driven a lot of those people are. And so obviously we can't take everybody. We're going to, launch with maybe 10, 15, max 20 people. And we want to keep it lean because we want to be very focused on having excellent teachers and teachers that we can help grow to be even better than they already are. But some of these people are so, even the ones that maybe didn't make that first round cut and like, you know, that we might look at later, they're so passionate and they just want, they just want to be in Bitcoin. They want to go and help people. They love it and they're hungering for it. And they just are, again, like they're, it's the brain drain in action. It's this calling that people feel when they notice the cracks in our society today, and then they see what they believe to be a solution, as all of us do. And they're like, I need to dedicate my time and my effort and the fruits of my labor to this in order to help this cause. And it's a wonderful thing to see. I did 5 interviews today with individuals that want to be part of the team. And it's just been a super exciting experience because I get to kind of see what's out there, how people are currently teaching things. By the time people get to me, I'm basically, they're teaching me something. So I'm playing the part of like a new Bitcoiner, and then they have to teach me, which is actually kind of cool to get, do that role reversal. But again, I got to tell you, there's some incredible people out there that are building their knowledge base. And if this is what the new class of Bitcoin has to offer, I'm very excited to see what is what's in store for us down the line and how much more effective we're going to get at teaching. And so it's my hope that with this whole Bitcoin mentor project that I'm working at, we will be able to level up all of these teachers to a point where they can just go forth and absolutely crush it in making sure that people know the tools and feel comfortable and confident that they can secure their Bitcoin and learn all the cherries on top that you want, running nodes and maybe diving into multisig and, you know, trying out all the cool new scaling tools and stuff that there are. I'm just so excited about the education space because it's huge and people are hungry to learn. So that's why I'm bullish. And I'll just generally open it up to you guys for anything that you want to chat about or in and around that space about where you think maybe we're at in education, where we're lacking, where we could grow, and where we're doing a good job.
Yeah.
Julian, go. Sorry.
No, like, I mean, Ben, you know, like, because you've been on this, like, I don't know, what year is it for you now in like content creation? Year 10?
So in Bitcoin, it's year 8.
Year 8. So you've been on this 8-year journey of essentially like from home broadcasting this message out and then, you know, responding to comments and you've done the workshops, which is not quite one-on-one, but it's like a little bit more personal. Mm-hmm. I've always like, I guess, maybe taken for granted the ability to learn something like one-on-one. Like I've done the same thing for languages or learning instruments, but I've never really thought about it that much for Bitcoin. My thing was always like, well, if you really want to understand Bitcoin, like you have to go seek it out. And I think honestly, like it's not one size fits all. I think people do need mentors and that kind of like one-on-one to get there. And I think what you're doing is really interesting because like, I think there's a few companies like Bitcoin Advisor and stuff like that doing this where they offer the one-on-one. And I think particularly for certain demographics, like maybe older people, they want that versus like sitting and watching a YouTube video. So this idea of getting like a collectives of, you know, Bitcoiners and kind of like linking them up with mentees is awesome. And I'm curious to see like where that goes, you know, moving forward. But yeah, it's a totally different process versus like you have a megaphone and you're shouting, you know, Bitcoin lessons out into the void and hoping people get it, right?
Yeah. Yeah. It's unique in that, you know, as Bitcoiners, I think up until now, we've maybe been teaching in a way, you know, we teach the virtues of low time preference, but when we teach about Bitcoin itself, we often try to teach it in a very high time preference way, right? It's like, all right, you're new to Bitcoin. Great. First thing you're going to do is you're going to download Bitcoin Core and you're going to run a full node. And then you're going to grab a cold card and you're going to put together your 305 multisig. And then, like, then you're going to run a full Lightning node. This is how you connect to channels and everything. Yeah. So like we attack it that way, thinking that the you know, the perfect little Bitcoiner that does everything great is the starting state, but it's not that, right? It doesn't matter what the first step is, as long as it leads to more steps. And if the first step you give somebody causes them to turn around and walk out the door, you have failed. Mm-hmm. So it's those initial steps that you need to take and those breadcrumbs that you need to sow to get somebody to follow along and go with you on a journey. It's a learning journey. Think of how long each one of us took to get to our current understanding of Bitcoin and how much further we'll go as we continue to understand it. Luckily, we have materials that get to expedite that process for people now and make it a little bit easier, but it's still a process. It's still something that is going to require steps. And you don't want somebody turning around and running away if you wanted to get them to level up to be an awesome Bitcoiner. So, yeah.
No, 100%. Like, I think as Bitcoiners, we've all gone through that step where we just like verbal diarrhea on your friends and you just rant about what you love the most. And like, you like, once you get that opening, you just like unleash on your friends and family and their eyes glaze over. And then you don't even care whether they get it or not. You just want to get the message out. And I think it's super important to like get the baby steps to people and be like, look, guys, there's an end goal here. But first and foremost, just like, you know, take your Bitcoin into custody, not necessarily like, yo, download Bitcoin Core, get yourself a 305 multisig. It's like, look, man, I get it. We all have this learning curve. And like, first and foremost, just take your keys, you know, take your Bitcoin off an exchange, download a mobile wallet. Like, it's not, you know, a silver bullet to it, but like small steps win. And I always say, you know, bait the hook for the fish you're trying to catch. And everyone that you talk to has a different need. They all look at Bitcoin. They all see certain problems in the world. And you have to just frame the Bitcoin solution in a way that they resonate with. And so, again, guys, it's like it's baby steps. I know we always do it. Maybe we've all been around for a while where we're kind of jaded now, where we're like, man, look, if you don't get it, I don't got time to convince you. You know, the classic Satoshi line. But what I think is super, super awesome is like, look at all of us. There's four of us. There's more of us out there. And the Bitcoin-only foundation of content creators is so strong that I fundamentally believe there's no excuse for people to go down the shitcoin rabbit holes unless they know that they're gambling on shitcoins initially, because there's so much good information. When I got into Bitcoin in 2017, we didn't have this Bitcoin only foundation. Like, I had to wade through so much mud to get here that now I look around at all of us, all of my friends, and we're like, man, we really have built a solid Bitcoin only foundation that they don't have an excuse to wreck themselves, because all they have to do is seek the content. It's out there. We like Ben, you know, Julian and Brandon, like, we literally show up every single day trying to spread the signal. And so all you really have to do is look for it. And to your point, Ben, like, I always remind myself that we are the Bitcoin IT team, whether we accept it or not. We are the ones that are orange pilling our friend. We are the ones that are teaching people how to get on the Bitcoin standard. And look at the biggest companies in the world. You know, Apple has literally like the Apple Care IT team, where they teach boomers how to use Apple computers. And Apple computers are simple to use. And here we are with like literally alien technology telling people, hey, you know what you got to do? You got to download a full node. It's called Bitcoin Core. It's going to take 2 weeks for you to download it on your computer. Trust me. And then buy yourself like $500 of hardware wallets. Dude, it's going to take you a little bit to learn. And everyone's like, what the hell are you talking about? So, guys, we say it all the time on Simply Bitcoin. Self-custody is the revolution. This is how we win. If enough people hold Bitcoin in their own custody, there's nothing they can do to stop the Bitcoin network. But we also got to understand humans are humans. And for better or worse, people want convenience. You got to kind of spoon feed them. Like, we're all grown children at the very end of the day. And we don't want to do too much stuff to secure our money. We're so used to the fiat system where like they literally spoon feed you how to save your money at a bank. And they're like, hey, if you mess up, guys, just call a number. We'll fix it to you. And in Bitcoin, you don't have that. Like, we don't have a rewind button. So we got to remember, it's baby steps for people. Because if you just look, I am the most bull-tarded out there, and I will verbal diarrhea on anyone. Every single day I have an opportunity, I'll do it. But I got to pull back and realize, like, look, this guy doesn't understand anything we're saying, and I just kind of have to, like, incept the ideas of freedom on them. I just got to kind of give them enough so that they can latch onto it emotionally, because most people don't think logically. I think Bitcoiners are the last Mohicans when it comes to thinking logically, and every NPC out there thinks emotionally and then they back rationalize everything. So you are the IT team, guys. You need to get your friends and family on Bitcoin, but don't scare them away. This is how we win, is by more people holding Bitcoin. And I believe it's inevitable. Like, guys, if you can send an email, if you can remember a phone number, you can hold Bitcoin directly. But hey, it's scary. It's new technology. I remember when I did my first transaction, I was absolutely terrified. I thought I lost my Bitcoin because I didn't know how it works. And most people just want to come for number go up. So, like, be patient with your friends and family. I know we all want to call them highly regarded, but just be patient. It's very important. And on that note, Ben, shouts out to you and the team, because you're doing Satoshi's work out there by one-on-one teaching people how to use Bitcoin. I literally had someone come up to me today and was like, man, you know, I did Ben's one-on-one session, and I didn't even know about you guys at Simply Bitcoin until Ben told me about you. And he's like, Ben's the greatest. He taught me how to take self-custody. And then I found you guys, and I love your show. And I'm like, Ben's out here spreading the word. Fucking love it.
Now, hopefully I told that person, I also told that person the good affiliate link to use, but we'll see.
Yeah, bitcoinworld.com/simplybitcoin.
A few times.
Yeah, exactly. Wow. Okay, Brandon, I'm curious your take on where we are with education and kind of where we're hopefully where we're going. What's your take on this?
Yeah, well, I feel like I need to, first off, catch Opti like he's Will Ferrell on Old School. Like, I think he's blacked out after that rant.
I am not at Opti the tank yet. Okay.
I got you. Whoa, what happened? I'll keep it short and pithy. I had notes here. Opti's got notes. I got notes, but I'm going to keep it short and pithy. I'll keep it short and pithy here. You know, Bitcoin's a human system at the end of the day. Bitcoin might run for 1,000 years, like Michael Saylor talks about, but it doesn't mean humans have to adopt it. And I think that's why education is so incredibly important. You know, it could run on its own, just keep going, it's doing, but if humans aren't using it, it doesn't matter. And I think that's why, for all of us here as content creators, for many of the people in the chat that are creators, people talking about it, you know, like Rusty in the chat, you know, people making art about it, every person counts exponentially towards this minimizing of the collateral damage, this bridge, this crossing of the chasm we need to get to from fiat to Bitcoin, or off the fiat debt-based legacy monetary Titanic onto the Bitcoin life raft. You have to make that transition as smooth as possible, get people on those lifeboats, and stop worrying about rearranging of the deck chairs. And, you know, what is Powell saying? And what are rates going to be? And, you know, all that, as Booth says, just gives credence to the old system. So put the energy into the new system. I know your previous sense, but it's the one person that is wavering for a second. We all have those moments. We're human, but keep going, because we need the 3%. And it's a human system. We need the humans. We need the education, because we have to cross this bridge somehow, some way, and make it as painless as humanly possible.
Yeah, I would totally echo that. Again,
Ben.
Yeah.
I was going to say, wait, Ben, can Brandon drop the 3% American meme on you guys real quick? I don't know if it's been dropped on BTC session.
No, what is it?
Brandon, go do it.
Well, yeah, really quick. So the Revolutionary War in America was roughly fought with 3% of the people, or at least the beginning was started with 3% of the people. And as Bitcoiners, we can see that, obviously, where we're in the sea of fiat, we're in the sea of crypto and altcoins. We can just see, like, why is there so few of us, right? And that's why where the education comes in. We only need a couple percent of the people. We don't need many people. And 3% in America, at least, turns out to be roughly about, what, 10 million people. So ironically, that's the mission of Swan. You know, like, you see this number thrown out, right? And there's something to it, and it's I don't know if it's a human number, it's something within humans or whatever it is, but it's 3%. We don't need many people. We just need to change sentiment. We need to educate people. As Breitbart said, you know, politics is downstream from culture, and you could say, you know, human psychology is downstream from culture. So we need to be those agents of change in order to force society the way we want to go. Because again, most people are asleep, they're sedating on whatever, drugs, pills, sex, rock and roll, I mean, whatever it is. They're going to be led by the 3%, the people that are the loudest intransigent minority. Hey, we need to go this way, the leaders of society. So that's the 3%. It comes from that, the Revolutionary War, and pushing society that way. And then what do you know? People start hopping on after that. And I think it was upwards of 30, 40, you know, percent of people were like, oh yeah, I'm for it. Let's go once we start winning. So we have to be the ones that push through to that, to get to that point though.
Yeah, totally agree. I'm just to kind of round out this education topic here, I want to show something because earlier I posted because fees spiked today, and I posted something earlier and I said, hey, fees are up again. You know, use the tools. Like, here's a couple things that could be helpful. If you don't already have like a Lightning wallet with a Lightning channel established for self-custody, you can do a workaround using the following things. And I have a couple videos on it. I post it. And somebody commented like, you know, I study a fair amount and like, I have trouble keeping up. How the hell is the world ever going to adopt this? Basically like worried about, but the reason I highlight this is because of how friggin' early we are. And the best example that I found was this video, and I'm gonna bring it up right now. I was watching it earlier. This is how to send an email in the 1980s, and this video, I'm gonna bring it back a little bit, and let me know if you guys can hear it okay, because it's absolutely hilarious. So just give me a thumbs up if you can hear it.
No, I can't.
Ah, damn, I'm trying to remember how these
you got to share. You got to share the win. There it is.
The tab. Oh, okay. Yeah. So there we go. Okay. So now let me know if you can hear this.
With the assistance of the outside broadcast unit, we will be linking from the database studio to their home. Pat Green and Julian, welcome to database.
Hello, Jane.
Hello, Jane.
Now, Julian, I see you have your computer linked to the telephone line. Can you tell us how you did that?
Yes, well, it's very simple, really. The telephone is connected to the telephone network with a British Telecom plug, and I simply remove the telephone jack from the telecom socket and plug it into this box here, the modem. I then take another wire from the modem and plug it in where the telephone was. I can then switch on the modem, and we're ready to go.
The computer
is asking me if I want to log on, and it's now telling me to phone up the main Prestel computer, which I will now do.
Literally takes a rotary phone. Wait, the dialing.
It's a very simple connection to make.
Extremely simple.
Extremely simple, you guys.
Extremely simple.
I can actually leave the modem.
This is me explaining hopping through like liquid and lightning to avoid on-chain fees.
I'm now waiting for the computer to answer me. It asks with a tone, and then I just flick a switch on the modem and replace the receiver. And
things are starting to happen.
Things are starting to happen,
you guys.
The Prestel computer is now asking me to enter my own personal password, which I've now done, and it comes up with an opening screen.
It's so good. We're a minute. I love it. Seriously, this exact panel here is going to take place in about 20 years, and it's going to be watching me explain how to use Bitcoin. And people are going to be like, look at that idiot and his stupid hair and him trying to explain how to use Bitcoin back then. Yeah.
And we literally said the same thing. Guys, it's so simple. All you got to do is run Bitcoin core node and, you know, and download a wallet and then go to a hardware. It's so simple. And yeah, amazing. Yeah. It's like looking in the mirror.
Yeah. It's amazing. I love this. Lightning goats in the chat. That looked like my goat feeder demo. Guys, if you haven't checked out Lightning Goats, you can feed goats with Lightning transactions in real time. We did it on Simply last week while we were in El Salvador. It was amazing. So you should probably check it out. But with that, we're going to put a bow on this topic, and we're going to do a rotation. I'm going to go to Opti and then Brandon first, because I feel like you guys are most in danger of losing a connection or having a computer die in the lobby of the hotel. So Opti, I'm going to toss it to you first. I'll cue you up with the same question that everybody gets. Why are you bullish?
Love it, love it. Well, Ben, first of all, you were being nice. By lose it, you mean us going off the plot and drinking a little too much of the sauce. We're having a little too much fun over here. All right, no, but for reals, why am I bullish? Everyone that watches my content knows that I'm a perpetual bulltard. I'm optimist fueled for a reason. I think Bitcoin's going to fundamentally change humanity. I'm always bullish on the Bitcoin price. I try not to be a number go up, bro, but it's hard not to be a number go up, bro, when you know it's going up forever, Laura. So my reason for being bullish here is I am seeing a perfect storm on the horizon. We cover the news every single day on Simply Bitcoin. And for the last year or so, it seems like the coverage on Bitcoin is getting better on corporate legacy media. I feel like we're seeing the Bitcoin ticker on every boomer news channel there is. Like, the defining conversation is becoming Bitcoin. And then, of course, I'm not an ETF fan, but we're seeing the institutional demand for Bitcoin increasing. They're literally buying up, what, thousands, hundreds of thousands of coins in the last month. And we have the halving in, what, 8 days or something like that? Bitcoin is literally, in the next 8 days, going to become the hardest money on planet Earth. Nothing can compete with Bitcoin. It's already better than gold on a, you know, stock-to-flow scarcity ratio. And now it's going to become the hardest money on planet Earth. And then, when you add that Bitcoin is already the fifth largest base money in the world, it's barely over $1 trillion. It just passed the silver market cap. I know I'm throwing a lot of macro at you guys, but we haven't even seen retail FOMO into Bitcoin. I got into Bitcoin in 2017, and it was literally the classic, the classic Wall Street meme where it's like when the shoe shine boy is talking about your stock, you know it's a top. And we haven't gotten to that point, and Bitcoin's already at all-time highs, basically. So institutional capital having coming up, Bitcoin's becoming the hardest money on planet Earth, and then retail FOMO coming in, and then legacy boomers talking about Bitcoin. Literally, they're sounding like the telephone fax guys about Bitcoin. And this is all happening at the same time when it seems like the legacy financial system's about to blow up. I don't know if you guys seen, you know, Jay Powell, Janet Yellen, my ex-girlfriend Chrissy Lagarde talk about fiat money, and they all literally have no clue how this money system works. All they're telling you is, hey, trust us, bro, we got this under control, we can manipulate the markets, and you guys can live your life. So all this is happening at the same time, and I am fundamentally convinced that probably, I don't know, a little after summertime, the Bitcoin price is going to start running. And all this is going to culminate into a mega, mega bull run. While all your NPC family and friends are sleeping on the sidelines, like, it's a perfect storm out there. I'm reminded of my buddy, Nick Can't Mine. He's head of Bitcoin Magazine's. He did a tweet. He was shitposting. And it was like Bitcoin shorts trying to stop the tsunami of Bitcoin demand. And it's a guy shooting with a shotgun shooting a wave of tsunami. Like, this is what's coming, guys. I, you know, again, forgive me. I am stupidly bullish always, but I'm just seeing all this happen right now. And I'm like, I don't think any of us are bullish enough on where this is going. And then not only that, add to the fact that I am most excited about the cultural shift that Bitcoin will force on people. It's not us forcing Bitcoin on people. It's the meme of people will adopt Bitcoin like gunpowder because they have to. And I'm seeing that we are getting all the factors playing in our favor. We have the best tailwinds possible. And then we have the coolest people. Like, we are literally the smartest people. Even though I'm an 80 IQ Bitcoiner, we are still the smartest people. Like,
there's no way we don't win.
I love it, man. It's like, you're right. It is a bit of a perfect storm, right? Pre-halving, already have hit all-time highs. Supply or income, you know, supply of new coins coming onto the market about to be reduced by half. All of this massive demand just gobbling up coins. Of course, we've got Grayscale like shitting out sats left, right, and center, but they're going to be, you know, they're running out of sats to shit. So they you know, and good riddance to them.
Ben, I don't mean to cut you off, but can I acknowledge this comment in the chat? John Pleb goes, Opti's reasons for bullish is price. No, what I'm saying is price is a fundamental factor to the fact that it's super scarce. It's becoming the scarcest money in the world. And the Bitcoin price is a real-time metric of people's understanding of Bitcoin. And I think people are starting to understand Bitcoin, or rather that they need Bitcoin. That is super bullish, in my opinion.
Yeah. Yeah.
I just did a short on this, actually. If you took Bitcoin in any four-year period since it was released, you had a portfolio of 95% cash and 5% Bitcoin. In any four-year time span, you would have outperformed the S&P 500 just by having 95% fiat and 5% Bitcoin. So it's like, is there an excuse to not own any of it? No, it's like, it's so asymmetrically to the upside. And that's any period. Like, obviously in the early years, it was going to outperform at that ratio. But we're talking like, you know, some of the bad years, like 2018 to 2022, you know, it didn't do a ton, right? Still outperformed the S&P at a 5% allocation versus cash. And it's like, I don't know. I don't know what to tell people anymore when they're like, it's too volatile, it's too risky. It's like, you guys are, just can't do math then. Like, I don't like the have fun staying poor, but when the amount of risk you actually have to take to buy some tiny percentage of Bitcoin in all of your wealth to be protected, you know, to protect yourself from inflation is that low, and you're still stouting the whole, like, it's too volatile, I'm too scared thing. It's like, I don't know what to tell you. Like, I guess, yeah, have fun staying poor.
Volatility to the upside or volatility to the downside holding fiat? I don't know. It sounds easy to me.
Yeah.
I think all that goes away now because at a button click, you can just, you know, stick it in your RRSP or 401k with the ETFs. Like, they're going to, what I just said right now is like a BlackRock ad. They will just say that at some point, right? So I'm giving them the narrative, and that's not great because, you know, BlackRock doesn't care about self-custody for, you know, the masses, but it's becoming a reality now that people can't escape, that essentially you don't have to go all in on Bitcoin. You just need a slice and get off zero ASAP, right?
Yeah.
So
I just want to give a shout out in the chat. Totally not the IRS says, hello, it's tax season. So shout out to totally not the IRS. Also, I need to address a gripe in the chat as well. Quit picking your beers. No, I'm going to do it more now.
Hey, Jay, good thing I don't have a beard.
I just shaved. So it's like kind of that like fresh little spiky feeling.
Yeah. Totally. The IRS says take risks, sell your Bitcoin, pay your taxes. Thanks IRS. I mean, totally not the IRS. So yeah.
They don't mean, not the other way around.
Brandon, do you want to touch on Opti's eclectic mix
price of predictions?
Yeah.
Repeat. I'm gonna have to pick them off the debate stage here again. No, similar to what you said, Ben, just, you know, the education side, honestly, I think that, to me, you know, Opti went macro again. I'll try to keep it somewhat pithy here, and another little Bill O'Reilly shout out, actually. That's one of his favorite words, pithy. So it's just education, you know. So he went macro level, I'll go micro level. Like my kids, you know, 7, 5, 3, and 1, you know, they know about the Federal Reserve. They know about Bitcoin. They know what money is. They know, like, the younger generations, you know, like, they know. They only grow up in a world that is Bitcoin. So, again, this is a little more long-term, I guess, you know, but it's a micro level in the sense of just seeing, like, my family. And like, I'm holding Ben pairing your BTC sessions, you know, style talks with my family, like family and friends. My parents are bringing people in. They're like, we're, you know, they're all sitting in the living room, you know, two dozen people. So this is, it's happening, you know, and I know there's many more people out there like this doing things like this. So it's, to me, at a micro level, I see it and I'm like, wow, like the people that are waking up and seeing what's happening, and it's going to happen gradually than suddenly, you know, like it's going to happen. It's this decade. I don't think we're gonna have to wait too long because bad things are going to happen. Unfortunately, like, again, trying to minimize the collateral damage, that bad things are going to happen. That's life, and people wake up, and that's how humans work. So it's a pretty simple equation, and we're here trying to minimize that collateral damage. It will happen, but we hopefully will be able to minimize some of it and usher people along that way, that path, and to not get as many people wrecked or help not get as many people wrecked. So to me, I think it's that. It's just the kids. It's seeing that at a micro level, seeing families, seeing people just continually waking up, seeing what's going on, showing clips of the, yeah, I just showed my mother the clip of the FDIC the other day, the thing from a couple of years ago, and them saying, yeah, there's going to be bail-ins. You know, that people don't need to know. You know, I've been showing a lot of people that clip, and it just, you know, people wake up. So anyway, that's, I'll keep it pithy. That's the reason why I'm bullish, just at a micro level of seeing what the kids are doing and what's happening and what they know nothing differently. Family level, they're waking up.
Wait. Can I add to that? Bullish on the kids. The kids out here living. The kids out here living.
Dogs. Yeah, I mean, again, Brendan, to your point around kind of seeing again, everybody kind of doing their thing and spreading the word and cluing into, again, the cracks in the system, understanding that something's broken and finding this as a solution. You know, again, we were just down in El Salvador and we were kind of seeing what was up there. My reason for being bullish last week was in and around me Premier Bitcoin and kind of what they're doing to educate an entire generation of kids that are you know, graduating from high school. And so, you know, I got to sit across from kids and ask them through a translator, like on my phone, questions like, what is inflation and how is it caused? And if you had asked me that when I was in high school, I would have no clue. I have no idea, because I wouldn't even know how money works, right? And these kids are not only learning like how Bitcoin works and all of that, but they're learning about how the existing system works, and inherently with that, what's wrong with it. And so there's this unique recognition of like, hey, we need to fix this, and these kids are going to take those lessons with them into adulthood, and help those lessons will help them form the basis of, you know, how they treat money, how they earn and save money, and if they build businesses, how they keep the fruits of their labor secured with that money. And that's going to, I think you're going to see, again, it won't be necessarily right out the gate, but give it 10 years, give it 15 years, and all of a sudden you've got an economy that has been built by kids that learned about the foundational principles of money. That's going to be an interesting case study to go over and say, well, how did this affect the economy moving forward when you have an entire group of kids that understand how money works? That, I mean, we're not getting it here. We're still not getting it. That's probably not going to happen anytime soon. It's only happening through alternative means of educating oneself. You're not going to get it through the schooling system. You're not going to get it if you go to college. You're going to get some Keynesian bullshit. So unless you're seeking it online in different mediums, you're never going to be exposed to it. And it's completely different in El Salvador and potentially in other places too, where this is getting introduced. And it's like it's like rocket fuel for kids' brains to understand how the economy works at that early of an age. So really cool to see in and around that. But I'll toss it to Julian for your thoughts in and around this.
Yeah, I mean, I've done a bit of traveling. We were in like Costa Rica. Richard has a school there and he's like teaching his daughter and like a bunch of kids about Bitcoin, and like they get it, you know. And the Me Premier Bitcoin stuff, I was watching last week's pod and it was awesome, like how the kids have that answer of, you know, what is inflation. It's easy. Bitcoiners have this obsession of trying to get sometimes people who are like so incentivized and far removed from wanting to understand money to get it. It's like they like the uphill challenge of, oh, I want to orange pill a central banker. I want to orange pill Elizabeth Warren. Like, come on, guys. Like, we can orange pill the Democrats. There are so many people that are like 80, 90% there ethically and morally and like logically, that it doesn't make sense that someone has to do it eventually. But like, we have so many people so close to our periphery. And I include children in that specifically because children are just naturally curious. Like, if you want to get Bitcoin, you have to have a level of humility and natural curiosity. And you know, unless you're, you know, an asshole, like private school kid or something, no offense, you don't know everything. And kids know that they don't know everything most of the time. And they're always willing to learn and they love new technology as well. So it's like a perfect match. And I'm so glad that like Meet Premier Bitcoin and all these programs are going after where Bitcoin is really wanted today. Ben, one of the things you told me, I asked you, I think like a year or so ago, like what your approach is to like going into merchants and asking them like, you know, to accept Bitcoin, like how do you orange pill business? And you said like, well, they have to want the Bitcoin. Like you're not going to get some business to accept it because it's like a good payment rail. Like they're going to have to want the asset itself. And it's like, there are so many people right now who want it and we should be going after them and they're not Bitcoin maxis yet. So yeah.
Yeah. 100%. Yeah. It's going to take time, right? Like there's going to be this gradual, I still kind of stand by my thesis that, people that understand Bitcoin kind of fall into a few different camps in terms of the pace at which people understand it. I think the people that are most disenfranchised, that have nothing to lose and have been cut off from the banking system or have been like experienced hyperinflation, those people are ripe to get it. But then on the opposite side of the spectrum, you've got people that are tasked with protecting massive amounts of capital or the purchasing power of massive amounts of capital, they're also primed to get it first because they're at risk of losing a lot and the other people have nothing to lose. And so those two parts of society, you're starting to see people in and around those parts be like, ah, this is useful, right? I think the disenfranchised maybe first because the other end was maybe risk averse until the risk became so great of just standing still. But then you've got the fucking weirdos, which is like all of us. so like we kind of have tuned into it maybe a tad early before a lot of other people. And so we just kind of get the benefit of being fucking weird and seeing this. But now it's starting to kind of pepper itself across just kind of regular Joes in society going like, what the hell? I had a good job. I was making a living. Nothing has changed. And now I can't afford rent. And so like, I think that's kind of where we're at right now, where it's like it's gone to the extreme ends of society plus the weirdos, and now we're peppering everything else. And yes, I see the weirdos in the chat. Tyler confirmed weirdo. higher calling.
Chrissy's in the chat.
Here's the thing. I don't think we have enough weirdos in Bitcoin. I'd welcome way more of us. I think we're only getting started with the weirdo count.
Yeah. Oh yeah, for sure. I think we all need to be weirdos. Like it's 100%. We don't change society until everybody gets weird, is my opinion.
Keep Bitcoin weird.
Yeah. Yeah. Chrissy Lagarde's invited.
You think anybody who went to Woodstock was normal? Like dude, that was millions of people gathering to some really weird shit and it was fantastic and they changed the world. Like we need our Woodstock in Bitcoin for sure.
Yeah. Yeah. 100%. I mean, is the that other- gonna
The other thing I was going to add really quick, Ben, just to my education part of why I'm bullish is just the overall like questioning of society. So you guys have all kind of touched on this. And this is something I've for years been thinking about. I was very political in the 2000s. So I'll be 37 in like 10 days. And so in the 2000s, I was in middle school, high school, into college, and I was very political. And, you know, you can't fix that system. It's what I didn't realize, right? When we're young, we think like, oh, we can fix it. We can vote in the right guy. And Julian, you touched on this earlier, right? Like you can't, like not possible. Rearranging the Titanic deck chairs. Good luck. Yeah. So, okay. Opie's not okay.
Another word enough.
Yeah. So to me though, seeing the talks though that people have now, I mean, just the overall sentiment of society questioning things. Like 20 years ago, if you would have told me as a kid, like a teenager or early 20s, like, hey, people are going to be questioning damn near everything in society in 2024. I would have looked at you, you know, like you were insane. Like, no, like people are just so out to lunch. They have no idea. They have no idea what is going on. And to see people nowadays on all spectrums in all facets of society questioning things, questioning, I mean, half the American population doesn't believe the election was counted correctly, right? Like all these things that people are questioning, it's not the result that necessarily mattered, but it was people questioning the system, things that are happening. to me, that is the biggest thing. As Bitcoiners know, trust but verify. When people start realizing, oh, there's not much in life I can verify actually, and I've just been playing this game for so long, yet that's, you know, a pawn in the system of these people moving things around. That's what, to me, is the biggest thing. And it really goes back to, and some, one of you alluded to it, the hippie bubble is what I think of it as, the older generations that are leaving power, the academia, the educational system, politics, they're gone. In the next 5-10 years, you think Nancy Pelosi or Mitch McConnell will be here 5-10 years from now? You know, like, they're not going to be here. You know, so like, the younger generation is here, and we're going to change everything. And that's what I think, that society, that iceberg flipping is coming, and society just doesn't realize yet. That's the gradually, then suddenly.
Yeah.
Sorry, CJ in the comments said, you guys are normal to me. Guess I'm not weird. I'm nuts. CJ, I paid 100,000 sats to get a puppet of Paul Krugman. You know, that's going to be generational wealth one day, and all I'll have is this stupid custom puppet. Bro. And wait, this is the beginning of the insanity that's about to come. So, okay,
Wait, Julian, just to make you feel even worse about that decision, if you were to split up all Bitcoin that will ever exist amongst every person on the globe today at 8 billion people, an entire lifetime worth of sats for a single person is 230,000 sats. So you just like spend
half of that is in this sock puppet.
Yeah.
I hope it generates some ROI for me. Zap me if you've seen a short with it. I want to make it back.
Wait. To that point, though, guys, I legitimately had this thought the other day. I was just sitting at home, you know, just got done live streaming. And I had a point of self-reflection. I was sitting there, like, just thinking of everything I'm into. And I'm like, I must be a fucking lunatic to a normal person when I start ranting about things, like the things we're into. I must sound like an absolute crazy person, and hence why I started this with the guys. Let's not like do the verbal diarrhea things. Like with friends, it's like awesome to rant, but like I must be an absolute lunatic to a normal person. Like, this is what I do normally. I just like start ranting on people, and they're like, this fucking guy is crazy. Like, what's going on? Like, what is going on with this guy?
It's true. I mean, yeah, I mean, yeah, you're crazy, Opti. It's fine.
Thank you.
But Brandon, to your point in and around, you know, people are recognizing, they're understanding something's wrong. I think Bitcoin does a really good job of making people realize everything is not what it seems. And that was actually my first moment of realizing that what I watch on the news, it can often be completely inaccurate, because the first time I ever noticed that was it was my first 2 months into trying to understand Bitcoin. And I understood in general, this is how it works. You know, like what a wallet was, you know, how to send and receive Bitcoin and just general stuff like that. And then Mt. Gox blew up shortly thereafter. And so then I saw the headlines. And the headlines were, Bitcoin got hacked, it's broken, and it's over. And I was like, that's not at all what happened. This was a bad company that held other people's Bitcoin and lost it. And I was like, whoa, that's not at all the correct. And they were stating it as fact. And I was like, this is completely wrong. But they're stating it as if it were true. And it, for the first time, I said, if I've barely begun to understand this thing, and I know for sure that's wrong, what other things on the news might I be thinking they know what they're talking about, but they just are just kind of throwing out whatever they think is correct? And so it made me kind of look in the mirror and look at society in general and start questioning a lot more, because it kind of shakes you when you watch the news and you've barely done any research, but you know for sure what they're saying is completely wrong. And I think this is where a lot of Bitcoiners get to, where they're like, and some can take, you know, sometimes you can take into an extreme and say everything on the news is wrong. You know, I will say, they don't have a great batting average, but there can be some truth in some instances. But it just makes you question everything, because you're like, well, what percentage is true? I don't know a lot about this topic. Could they be incorrect here too? So yeah, Bitcoin absolutely makes you go, whoa. I thought I could just trust this box in front of me to tell me what's real and what's not. And it turns out I cannot. And so maybe I should start thinking for myself. That's a hard hurdle to get over, but it's one that's very worthwhile. Yeah. I gotta go back because I saw something in the chat. Of course I gotta pull. Yes, totally not the IRS. Is you're not the only one. Totally not the IRS. That's crazy for Miss El Salvador. I know somebody in the room is.
Aren't we all?
Somebody got an award for that, you know. anyways, gents, with that, we're going to do one more rotation. I'm going to put a bow on this topic and I'm going to toss it to Julian. And dude, I'm going to cue you up with the same question everybody gets. Why are you bullish?
I am bullish because in my Bitcoin journey, I've done a lot of stuff alone, and content creators all know this journey. You start out, you're crazy enough to start making videos, and it's a lonely road. I guess the same you could say for developers. You could say the same for entrepreneurs. When you start on these journeys, you usually don't have a co-founder, or a lot of the time you don't, and you grind, and there's not many people you can relate with and share that journey with. And you know, my big thing that I announced like a couple days ago was I'm transitioning from being a solo content creator to sort of having a crew of people. And I've never been a team player in my life. I've always been the, like, you know, I'll just do it myself thing. I can't trust anyone. You know, I gotta just, you know, wear all the hats. And I finally, as a person at like, you know, age like 28, I'm finally getting over that, thanks to Bitcoin. And I think it's an important lesson for all Bitcoiners, because we have like all these sovereign individuals, but no man is an island. And I think for the first time, you know, maybe it's just bull market vibes, I'm starting to see a lot more people to come together. Opti, I know before you were, you know, in the Simply Bitcoin stuff, it was Nico grinding that show out on his own. Ben, I know, you know, you used to be like a one-man channel and now Nico's on, and I used to be a one-man band. But like, and like teaser, in the next like 4 days, I have the most insane collaboration of like 15 Bitcoiners coming out. But like, nothing like that's been done before. 15 Bitcoiners in like one insane video. You're going to see it Wednesday or Thursday, depending on when Nico gets back to me. But I'm starting to see that for the first time in the Bitcoin space, all of us coming together, working together, putting away the like, I'm the one man show lone wolf thing, and really starting to collaborate. And that is where I think magic is going to start to happen. The stuff that we produce as creators, as developers, as entrepreneurs, when we start working together, that is how we're going to break out of this echo chamber. Because we love to, like, you know, wax about Saylor versus Odell, and like this person said that and that person said that, but we don't celebrate when people come together and really create something. And I think, it's starting to happen at a clip. And when you are together, that's when you become unstoppable. You can't get singled out for being a weirdo or a crazy person, or you can't get canceled if you're like, you know, 20 people driving towards like the same mission. They can cancel you if you're on your own. They can if you're working together. So that's the reason I'm bullish. I see all the Bitcoiners coming together, making some incredible stuff, from media to businesses. And that is going to be what propels us into the limelight.
I like that. It's an echo of what was mentioned earlier by Brandon, with Jeff Booth and his, you know, rather than putting energy into, you know, he always says, you know, if you yell at the existing system, you embolden it and you give it power. If you put your energy towards the new system, that's you grow it and you shrink the old one. And I think maybe the same can be true of where you put your energy, just in general of the type of people you surround yourself with and the way you engage with people. If you're constantly screaming and yelling at other people, you're wasting energy that could have been spent building something positive for others and doing something positive for others. So I think that's a great way to think of it. And I, you know, I'm super stoked on what you're putting together over there with Isabella and Adam, both like super personable, like, you know, pump out killer content, like so fun to be around. And that comes through in the footage and their, you know, the way that they interact with the audience and with, you know, when you're watching it, you feel like you're talking with a friend. And I hope that comes across to other people, because it sure as hell comes across to me. And I can say from firsthand experience that their personalities on the screen are the same as when they're in person. Like, they carry the same energy. Like, you walk into a room with Adam and he starts talking, you're like, holy shit, he's literally like, it's on the video. Like, he's so full of energy all the time. And same with Isabella, she's just like fucking ready to go at all times. It's awesome.
I don't know if I've like told the story too publicly, but I'll try and keep it brief. Like, the reason that Isabella is a part of this, I met Adam like a year and a half, 2 years ago. We went down to Guatemala, we did this video. I've like was like, okay, I'll figure out something so that we can like collaborate together at some point. But Isabella was like, I had this idea to go to Peru to shoot this documentary on Motive, which is this nonprofit that is strictly using Bitcoin as sort of this medium of exchange for unbanked people in really far out places. And I thought, okay, well, I need another documentary. This sounds good. But number one, it's like eight different circular economies across Peru. So it's not just like one plane ticket in and out. It was going to be very expensive. And number two, like, my Spanish is not good. And so I was like, okay, I need another Bitcoiner that can like join me on this journey. And I saw Isabella post one day that she was Peruvian. So I just DM'd her and I said, you want to come? Like, I know you don't know me and this is like weird. And I'm just like some random guy who like makes weird TikToks. And she was totally down. And ever since that trip, and that video is coming out in about, I want to say like a month or a little over a month. That trip was an unbelievable bonding experience. You could not get a more insane bonding experience than going from like the Peruvian highlands where the oxygen is about like half as normal in like density, to like the desert, to the jungle, to this like super intense deep part of the Amazon that doesn't even have roads going into it, all to make a video about Bitcoin. And it's like, man, I want to see other people going on these journeys in the Bitcoin space. Like, I get it, you know, we like our podcasts, we like our books, it's cozy and comfortable, but like when Bitcoiners get out and those creative juices start flowing amongst us, like, it produces some really incredible stuff. So
I agree.
Yeah.
Also, shots fired in the chat. Totally not the RS, says Isabella. It's greater than missile.
Yeah, software. I can attest to that.
I mean, at least when you ask her to hang out, she hangs out.
Yeah, her problem is she doesn't say no to anyone. That's the only problem.
No, Miss El Salvador is actually pretty chill. I, myself and a dude named Justin Orkney gave her a ride in his rental car from the having party out to Bitcoin Beach. Curiously, she didn't take Opti up on any of his offers to hang out. So maybe that's just a him problem, not a her problem.
Definitely a him problem.
Awesome. Yeah, no, it's you're absolutely right. Like, if any Bitcoiners are in the room, you know, in the chat right now, and you still haven't interacted with Bitcoiners face to face, honestly, you're missing out. Like, it can be very isolating not having somebody in your life that has this same passion. And the first time you get into a room with another Bitcoiner, it's just like this release of like, oh, thank God I can talk about Bitcoin and somebody actually gives a shit. Like, it's like you're so used to like you bringing it up to family and they're like, oh, here we go. Okay, yeah, pretend to be interested. Mm-hmm. Yeah, like that's the vibe that you get when people don't care and you've tried. But you get to an event or a local meetup or whatever, or if you don't have a local meetup, create one. But like you gotta talk to other Bitcoiners. Like you can't just stew on your own. And eventually everybody's going to be a Bitcoiner, and then you'll have missed this unique opportunity to be able to talk about and understand that you and somebody else uniquely get this seismic shift that we're about to go through. and nobody else around you does. And that's a pretty special feeling having that. It almost feels like you somehow know a secret. And even though you're trying to tell everybody the secret, they refuse to listen to it. And so that's kind of where we're at, right? Like you have these experiences and you're like, guys, listen, this is so important. Something is about to happen. You need to know. And everybody's like, nah. And to finally, you know, it can be pretty impactful. Like when I went down to Costa Rica, I just kind of put out online. I was like, hey, I'm going to be in this area. Are there any Bitcoiners around? And there were a couple guys that reached out and they were like, hey, I'm, you know, cool that you're down here. And I ended up meeting up with each of them. One of the guys had never met another Bitcoiner in person. It was the first person he ever met that also was into Bitcoin, but he had been through the fucking ringer. He was from Canada. He was running a business. He was doing all this stuff. And then all the restrictions came down. And he made the hard decision of uprooting his entire family, both like three of his kids, like basically abandoning his business that he had been working on for like a decade. And he got the hell out of there and he went down to Costa Rica to like start an entirely new life. And he was like, obviously like very much into Bitcoin. And that was like one of his lifelines in doing that. And like, I met up with him. And he's just telling me his story of like, this is what I've experienced. And he's like, I can't tell you how much it means to finally be able to talk to somebody about this and know I'm not crazy. Like there's other people that are the same as me. And dude actually had tears in his eyes because he's just like, I can't imagine what the guy had been through, like to make these types of decisions, just like move his entire family out of the country he'd been in for his entire life. On top of it, have this like inner, like he knew something was happening, something was important. And he was just hoping that he wasn't just like batshit crazy. And he's making all these rash decisions and everything. But he had never spoken to somebody who got it. And I just got to sit across from him and be like, yeah, man, I get it. And like, he teared up because it was just like this final release of like, oh God, finally, like there's somebody that gets it and like that I can connect with. So yeah, if you've not experienced that yet, oh my God, you got to go and you got to meet other Bitcoiners because it's a unique perspective to be sitting on the cusp of this thing and get what it means before most of the world. Yeah. And I just want to give a shout out to, I see Kendall in the chat.
He was down Kendall.
Wow. She's super awesome. Matt says, Opti, check your OPA. He's checking it right now. That's awesome. Yeah. So I don't know. That's kind of my take there. I don't know, gents, if you want to chime in on anything else here that comes to mind.
No, I would want to say that education is key. Once again, I mean, you guys fired me up, and this is why we're bullish, you know. So like, it's incredible things. Like Julian, I love what you said, Julian. It's so true. People like coalescing, coming together. Community is the number one thing in a survival situation. And that's a little known fact. And unfortunately, most people think it's like water, food, or gold, or whatever. You know, it's like, no, it's community. It's the people around you coalescing, coming together, knowing your neighbor, knowing the people around you, building, coming to conferences, doing things like this together digitally and in real life. So you can build these relationships so that way when times are bad or things do hit the fan, you have the resources you need and whatever you're short on, because we're all going to be short on something, that you can do that. So coalescing, coming together, Julian, like you said, a lot of us Bitcoiners, I'm guilty of that my entire life. When I grew up playing hockey, I was a lone wolf. I was, you know, like that was just my thing. I'd work out on my own. And I was like, you know, just like lone wolf attitude. And there's, I'm sure, a lot of Bitcoiners that are like that, but we need each other. You know, the businesses need each other. We need to collab. We need to partner up. We need to do things together, because we're only going to defeat the monetary demons if we come together.
Yeah, like quick aside on that, like the bear markets are so much easier when you have other Bitcoiners that you know as well. I still wanted to make videos during the bear market, even though it was impossible to get sponsors. And I just like, you know, I don't ask people to volunteer to like shoot stuff for me often. I'm trying to make sure people are paid. But I was like, fuck, it's a bear market. Like, I don't want to sell Bitcoin. I keep making these videos. So I'll just see if any Bitcoiners want to help me out. And they did. And I said, okay, like when the bull market rolls around, like you're getting paid next time. And sure enough, here we are, you know, shortest or easiest bear market ever. But yeah, like make your Bitcoin community as big as you possibly can. It'll make you invincible through anything that happens. So
I want to add to this because Julian brought up a great point.
I think it froze.
To like the black sheep of my family, and did we freeze?
No, you're good. Are we back?
Okay, yeah, sorry guys, the lobby internet's trash. All right, so to Julian's point, I've always kind of considered myself a lone wolf. I've always kind of considered myself a black sheep. I'm still the black sheep to this day. Uh-oh.
You're here. You're good.
Am I back? It looks okay.
You're good.
All right. But one thing I've realized throughout the last 2 years is you go a lot farther when you're a part of a team than you do alone. I don't want to get like, you know, biblical here, but it's literally a quote in the Bible. It says, when two or more pray in my name, when two or more come together in my name, you are unstoppable. And that's what it means to be a Bitcoiner. When we all meet up, we're at the floor of the Bitblock Boom lobby right now. When all of us Bitcoiners congregate, this is how we take over. We're much more powerful in numbers. And one thing we've learned, at least me and Nico at Simply, and we have this conversation all the time, is that all of us Bitcoiners consider ourselves individuals. And when you try to label us, we all have like a knee-jerk reaction and we all are like, no, I'm not that label. But when you come together as a team, we don't all have to get along. This doesn't have to be all kumbaya here. But when you align yourself with other people that think like you, that are on the same mission, we are literally unstoppable. Like Julian was saying, you know, I've been making content for a long time. I've been doing this alone for a long time. I literally left my hometown to come hang out with Bitcoiners because I realized that when I'm surrounded by more Bitcoiners, I'm not only more invigorated, but I understand that I'm not alone. And I'm reminded to myself that, oh, there's more people that think like me. And so find yourself a wolf pack. Find yourself people around you that think like you, that want to build on the same thing, that have the same purposes, because alone, yeah, you may be strong, but when you are aligned with a few other people on the same purpose, you are literally unstoppable. That's what Nico and I did at Simply Bitcoin. We built a team around us. That's what Julian's doing with building a team at GetBase. That's what Sessions is doing with building a team behind him. You guys don't know the team behind Sessions, but we are not alone. Every content creator that you love, they don't even have to be in Bitcoin, but they have a team behind them. So, guys, associate with other Bitcoiners. Get out of your mom's basement. Get off the internet. Go touch some grass. Get in touch with other people that are building cool ass shit, because this is how we win. You're not going to win by just sitting back and hodling Bitcoin. Yes, you will get wealthy, but we got to build the businesses. We have to push the culture forward. And again, guys, you know, I hate saying we, but we as in like you and your friends, like me and Simply Bitcoin, we're doing our thing. Julian and the Get Base team. Shouts out to Adam. Go to bitcoinwell.com/simplybitcoin. And Session with his team. This is how we win, because we are warriors out here. Guys, you know, Brandon said it earlier. We are facing the monetary demons. It is literally good versus evil. We are much more powerful when we are aligned with like-minded individuals than we are alone in our little silos. We have the best money in the world. We have the best perspective in the world. And literally nothing's going to stop this train. It's all about the message. It's all about the Bitcoin network. It's not about the individuals. But alone, you are a lunatic. When you're with a bunch of other people, you're not just a lunatic. You're right. And we're right. So just continue to congregate with other like-minded individuals. And we are literally unstoppable. Shouts out to all the Bitcoiners building teams right now, because this is how we win.
Yep. Satoshi didn't do it alone, and neither should we. That's it.
Wait, no, this is fake news. Do not read the ticker.
I'm just going to leave that for the rest of the episode.
All right, I'm out. Bitcoinworld.com/Bitcoin.
Amazing. Okay, well, gentlemen, this has been an absolute blast. I'm going to start rounding us out, but At the end of the episode, I always like to do something. I like to just go around, do a quick round of any final thoughts that you may have. But more importantly, I love to get recommendations from my guests. So those recommendations can take any form. It could be maybe you saw a new article, maybe you listened to a pod, maybe you have a really good book that you read, maybe there's a new app or device that you've used that you think is awesome, or maybe it's just a piece of life advice, something that somebody can go out and do and meaningfully improve their life in and around Bitcoin, or a topic that's tangential to it. And so final thoughts here are, again, go out and meet your local Bitcoiners, create a meetup, go and build relationships. Again, as Opti was saying, we're stronger together than apart. And that's important. That's kind of what I'm taking from this. Everything that we've talked about has been in around building up the people around us, either through education or partnership a variety of different means. In terms of recommendations, things to check out or to support, I guess just in relation to supporting other Bitcoiners and, you know, some of the like controversial news of the day. If we want to keep it positive and work towards building a better future and focusing our energy on the things that we would like to see and the world that we would like to see around us. Well, if you want to do that, then you can go to opensats.org and you can donate to open source developers. This is in and around Bitcoin. This is around any sort of freedom tech. OpenSats is badass. And what you can do is anything that you donate, which can all be done through Bitcoin, you can donate to the general fund. OpenSats doesn't keep a penny. It all goes passed through directly to any of the, it goes directly to the recipients or the developers that are building cool shit. And so the general fund just gets divvied up. Or you can pick a specific project that you very much value and donate directly to that one. Again, OpenSats keeps nothing. It goes directly to them. And you can even claim it if you want. It's tax deductible. So again, Bitcoin Core, Graphene OS, BTC Pay Server, Amethyst. There's so many different projects that you go and donate to, and it's super simple to do. You can donate in Bitcoin. There's so many different options. When I click check out the funds, there's Geyser, there is the Nostr Fund, there's different projects like BTC Pay, Tor, Domus, Bitcoin Core, Cashew, Amethyst, Graphene. There's so many different cool Sparrow Wallet I use all the time, Zeus, Seed Signer, Thunder Hub, RGB, all kinds of awesome stuff that you can support. So yeah, head over to opensats.org and just take a peek. And if you find something there that you use a lot and you appreciate that tool, realize that somebody built that shit for free. And how much value have you gotten out of it? And if that value is more than zero, maybe you'd consider pitching a few sats towards that project. I know just looking at that page, Thunderhub, Amethyst, BTC Pay, Sparrow Wallet. Oh my God, Sparrow Wallet. Do I ever use the shit out of that? I should be emptying all of my sats directly into that one. Damas, Bitcoin Core, I mean, obviously. Zeus, Cashew, like these are all things. Seed Signer, all of these things are things that I either have used or use on the regular. So peek over there, see what you see, and if you're feeling like you want to give back, it's a good place to do it. So go check it out. Also go to bitcoinwall.com/btc sessions.
No. Wait, you stole mine. Damn. There was my punchline. That was gonna be my call of action, Ben. Go to bitcoinwall.com/bitcoin. No, guys. Seriously, go to bitcoinwell.com/bitcoin. No. All right, my call of action, besides obviously propagating the memes and congregating with more Bitcoiners, is just realize that what we're doing here is is we are changing the world. And the way you do this is by providing value to your fellow man, saving your excess in Bitcoin, and living a good life. You are a walking billboard for Bitcoin. So the main thing you need to do is live a good life and show your friends and family that this is the way that they win. Everyone is out here just trying to live a good life, and we have the best money in the world, which means it is paramount that you live a good life. Get healthy, get your mind right, get your body right, continue to win, continue to spread the memes. This is how we win. And the call of action is go to bitcoinwell.com/simplybitcoin.com. No, go watch Bitcoin content. All right, I'm out.
All right, Brandon, it's up to you. If you tell me to go to bitcoinwell.com/simplybitcoin, then I will end it.
Can't even say it like him, so I'm not even going to try. If you're having, I will shill. If you're having a hard time, like I said, the kids, if you're having a hard time shilling, or I'm shilling this, but you're having a hard time orange pilling people, here you go. So we just dropped these, the Having Edition Whale packs. So some incredible packs there. You get the boomer ones too. Bitblock boom one. So I will say the orange pill in a pack. So yeah, that's why they're there.
I have never look at the boys. A good reaction to a Bitcoin product before. Seriously.
Yes, yeah. You guys all made great content about it. Yes. Look at that. It's beautiful. And the reason again is education. And it's to orange pill people. It's the Trojan horse. And that's the point of it, is to incept it into people's minds, young, old, academics, politicians, doesn't matter. Use it for all. And be judicious. And then what Opti said too, you know, treat your body right, treat it well, and take care of yourself. Because again, that's, we are the beacons, we are the billboards of what we're trying to do. People aren't going to take us seriously if we're looking all sloppy and looking disheveled. So take care of yourself. And yes, Lonnie, I will get another drink here. It's all the people here left and went to dinner. So, but we want to stay and hang out with you guys. That's why we're here. So all of our waiters and waitresses left to give me another drink.
You guys for sure wish they went to dinner.
No, I would not miss an opportunity to show bitcoinwell.com/bitcoin.
That one even got me.
Wow. Awesome.
No, I love you guys. I love you, Ben. Shouts out to Julian. Shouts out to the chat. We love you.
Okay. Toss it to Julian for his final thoughts, and then we'll wrap it. Julian, any final thoughts, recommendations? You're all you.
Okay. Recommendation. And I trust me, like, I hate shilling my own stuff, but in about 6 days, sometime before the halving, when Nico gets back to me, Opti, you know what this is about.
Hey, Julian, I saw the rough cut and Nico saw it for a moment. He's like, oh shit, I need to get back to Julian. So it's going to happen this weekend. I'll make sure.
Okay, good. We have the craziest, most fun Bitcoin video like I have ever seen, with 15 different Bitcoin content creators, coming out hopefully Wednesday, a couple days before the halving. The way to see it is follow us on YouTube or Twitter, either Kinetic_finance on Twitter or Get Based on YouTube. It's going to be there. It'd be fun to do like a live watch of it or something. Ben is in it. Nico's in it. Joe Nakamoto's in it. Like every crazy Bitcoin psychopath is in this video, coming out in the next like 5 days. So highly recommend that. And it's going to be one that hopefully you can send to your friends too. It'll be a bit normie friendly. But it's like, if there's anything that captures how insane, but like loving and, you know, wanting to push the world forward our group is, it's that video. I'm so proud of it. I'm so proud of like everyone who made a part in it. So yeah, you'll see that very soon. It'll be called 15 years of Bitcoin in 15 minutes or something like that. So yeah.
Dude, I'm stoked. I'm glad I could be part of it.
You crush your part. You crush it. I love it. I love it so much.
Do you know how many takes I had to do to get all that out? It was crazy.
It was amazing. It's like perfectly the 1 minute mark too.
Awesome. All right. Well, everybody watching, number one, go follow Simply Bitcoin, but also don't use their promo code.
Lies.
Go check out Bitcoin trading cards. They are Brandon, what's the website for Bitcoin trading cards?
It is btc-tc.com.
Okay, btc-tc.com. And then of course go follow Get Based on YouTube, and Julian is everybody's Twitter handle is down below, and also all of you are on Noster, correct?
Yes.
Okay, cool. I tagged you guys all on
this. I got my NPub remembered. It's NPub. No, I don't.
Love it. So I tagged all these guys on Noster as well. So make sure that you go check them out and follow them there. And this was an absolute blast, guys. So thank you guys so much for being here. Really enjoyed it. And of course, you're all welcome back anytime. Have a great rest of your evening.
Thanks for having us, brother.
All right. Yeah,
thanks, Ben.
Cheers, gents. I'll see you later.
See you guys. Great show.
All right. And everybody, thank you guys for being here. Thank you for being in the chat. This was a blast. Also, thanks for sticking around despite the technical difficulties at the beginning. Fuck it. We'll do it live. And we did it, mostly. And Opti's still backstage, so I'm just going to use this one moment where he can't talk to once again say bitcoinwell.com/BTC sessions. His code is trash. Like, never use it. No matter how many times he says it, never use it. Always use mine instead. Much, much better. It gets you more points, I think, probably too. So anyways, Opti's back. So he's in the private chat. This motherfucker, tough man. This is my show. I call it here. This is what I do. But again, everybody in the live chat, appreciate you guys being here. Love you guys. Thank you for getting bullish with me on a Friday. Of course, you can go ahead and like, subscribe, share, all those things. Super important. If you want, you can also hit up my website, btcsessions.ca. Tons of good stuff for you to check out. I'm going to give one more shout out to sponsors of the show as we round it out here. I'm going to run them all because, this got kind of clipped into two episodes. So I'm going to run them all here. Again, if you want to support the show, you can check out any of them. But for that, I am out. Have yourselves a wonderful Friday. I'll see you guys next time for your daily session. Well is on a mission to enable independence by being one of the easiest and quickest ways to purchase Bitcoin in Canada and the US. And the best part about it, every buy goes directly into your own self-custody. They never hold your coins. You can add a Bitcoin address as part of onboarding. There's a transparent 1% spread, no hidden fees, no withdrawal fees. Plus they have KYC free sells and bill payments on their website. They're also a publicly traded company under the ticker BTCW on the TSXV. Check them out over at bitcoinwell.com. Check out my full tutorial on how to use them. And you can check out the links in the show notes down below and sign up today. CoinKite.com has some of the best hardware on the market today to secure your Bitcoin. The Cold Card Q is an absolute powerhouse and is my daily driver. And on top of this, they have plenty of other goodies, including the Mark IV, the Tap Signer, Open Dimes, the Block Clock, and much more. If you head over to their website, make sure you use code BTCSessions at checkout to get a nice discount. Links are in the show notes down below. Backups are important, and CDOR.io has one of the most robust and beautifully designed steel backup solutions on the market today. You can stamp your seed phrase into solid steel with one of their starter kits for one or two seeds, and secure your seed phrase from the elements like fire, water, and corrosion. On top of this, if you ever need to swap out any of the information therein, you can just grab a new set of disks and slide them into the capsule as you see fit. I've done a full tutorial on them that you can check out. Otherwise, click the links down below for the best shipping options for you. BitcoinWallet.com allows you to borrow against your Bitcoin in a non-custodial way. Collateral is held in a 3 of 4 distributed multi-sig with trusted parties. It provides institutional liquidity providers loan periods of up to 5 years with flexible conditions and the best rates. And best of all, no rehypothecation of your funds. If you want to check them out today, head over to debify.com or hit the link in the show notes down below. Start9 is your sovereign computing solution, allowing you to use plug-and-play devices to host not only your Bitcoin stack, but your digital life. You can run things like your Bitcoin core node, your Lightning node, mempool.space, JoinMarket, as well as your personal data, files, passwords, photos, Noster relays and clients, and even some AI tools without censorship. They have everything from entry-level devices all the way up to what I'm running, which is the Start9 Server Pure. You can check them out over at start9.com and be sure to use code BTC Sessions with a plus sign in order to get an 18% discount off of the Server Pure. When it comes to assisted multisig and inheritance planning, it's hard to beat nunchuk.io and their Honey Badger program. On your mobile device, they allow you to set up a full multi-signature vault. And once it's done, you have baked in inheritance planning so that your Bitcoin gets to your next of kin if anything should happen to you. On top of this, the entire thing can be set up with devices like the Tap Signer, the Cold Card, and plenty more options. And the whole thing can be done without KYC. You don't need to give up your personal information to have it set up and working for you. You can check them out today over at nunchuk.io.
HODL the Bitcoin.